We have lots of selves inside. It's a whole menagerie. Different selves play different roles. And the Buddha picked out three that are helpful on the path. They're different forms of becoming. And eventually you're going to have to let them go. But you have to train them first. It takes work. I've heard some people say, well, so much work, why don't we just let go? Why do we have to bother with all this work? We let go and you're back where you were. And where you were is not the end of suffering. It's immersed in suffering. So what are these selves inside that you got to work with to get out of that suffering? There's the self as the producer, the one who wants to create happiness and feels that it has the means to do that. There's the self as the consumer, you who's going to benefit from the work of the producer. And then there's the reflective self, you might call it the director, who watches over the other two. Make sure that the producer is not lazy. Make sure that the consumer is neither too demanding nor not demanding enough. And then this reflecting self has many levels, because the reflector has to reflect on the reflector sometimes to make sure the reflector is not being too critical. So it's helpful to think about these things. You can ask yourself when you're sitting down to meditate, who's in charge? And are the different selves working together? If you find this too much to think about, remember, you're not here to focus on yourselves. You're here to focus on your breath. Focus on the breath first. And then as you get used to being with the breath, you can't help but notice that your mind is relating to the breath in different ways. There are times when the mind wants to simply enjoy the breathing. Others when it's trying to figure out why you can't enjoy it. What's going on? Is the breath uncomfortable? Or is the mind simply too antsy to want to settle down? This is where you analyze the problem. And then you try to make changes. When a sense of ease comes up, sometimes the consumer will want to take over and just say, I just want to wallow around in this pleasure for a while. And there are passages where the Buddha says that you do indulge in the pleasure, but you have to figure out how much is too much and how much is enough. If you drop your work entirely and simply wallow around, after a while the causes run out, and you're back where you were before you meditated. If you don't allow yourself to enjoy it, then there's not going to be any pleasure in this. So as we were saying today, there may be a time when you have to soften your focus a little bit to allow for the pleasure. And then think of it going through the body, because the pleasure is there to work with. It's not there simply to enjoy. Or we might say, you can enjoy it. You can't enjoy it when it first comes, but you don't eat it all up. And John Lee's image is of having a coconut tree. And the coconut will give fruit. And if you eat up all the coconuts, that's all you have, one tree giving fruit. But if you take a couple of the coconuts and you plant them, then you have more trees. You eat the coconuts from those, but you plant some of them. You don't eat all of them. And after all, you become, as he says, a millionaire with a coconut orchard. So it's up to you to get a sense of what the balance is, and this is where your reflective self comes in. What's the balance between working at getting the concentration going and enjoying the results? You can think of another analogy. It's like someone who's gotten a new job, and they get their first paycheck, and they quit the job, and they go and they spend all the money. And then they're poor again, and they come back and they ask for the job back. And you can imagine in the world, if someone did this, it would be a very kind boss who would actually take them back to begin with. But there wouldn't be much prospect for that person to get very far in his work, because he gets his next paycheck and he quits the job and goes off and spends the money again. The trick is learning how to stick with the work and enjoy the results of the work at the same time. Because there is work to be done. Those schools of thought that say, well, just simply let go, and there you are, the unconditioned. Let go, and there's the space all around you. Well, there's space, but it's not the unconditioned. And if there's still greed, aversion, and delusion in the mind, what are you going to do? They have to be dealt with. And you need the concentration in order to deal with them. Otherwise, they'll come on strong and they'll overwhelm you. And if they're clever, you won't realize that you've been overwhelmed. So to get past these things, you've got to get the mind really still so you can see the subtle things going on in the mind. Because if the mind isn't really still, it's creating a lot of noise. It's like trying to figure out if there's a mouse in your wall, but you're running around making a lot of noise. You're never going to hear the mouse. You're lucky if you hear it every now and then. But if you're making a lot of noise, you might assume that there's no mouse there at all. You have to be very quiet, sometimes for long periods of time. Then when the mouse thinks that there's nobody there, that's when it'll start moving, scratching here, scratching there. Then you know you've got a mouse in the wall. Then you can track it down. So don't abort the path by letting go too quickly or dropping the work too quickly. You keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. It gets more subtle. And that sense of well-being that comes from the concentration, it gets more solid over time. And sometimes there really is a temptation just to say, well, this is good enough. But if you're seriously concerned about any possibility for the mind to lie to itself or to deceive itself, or any possibility that the concentration might start falling apart, that's when you've got to keep looking, looking, looking. Where are there still any disturbances in the mind, even in the concentration? Because the concentration, after all, is fabricated. It's made of your intentions. And even though you try to make your attention as steady and unmoving as possible, still there's going to be some wavering. Only if you're really still can you see that. And only if you're really earnest will you say, this does matter. Here again, the lazy approach is, well, it's a little bit of movement, doesn't matter at all, just that's the way it is. It's the people who keep questioning, that's the way it is. Those are the ones who get far. Think of Isaac Newton, whether he actually sat there and watched the apple fall from the tree. He did ask that question, why does the apple fall? And science up to that point had said, well, it's the nature of apples to fall. And when he asked why, people said, well, why are you digging up this question? It's already been settled. He said, no, it hasn't. Why is it that apples fall but the moon doesn't fall? He said, well, the moon is a different kind of substance. Again, they thought the question had been settled. But he kept pursuing it. and finally came up with the laws of gravity that govern apples and moons and the earth. And with that knowledge, we've been able to do an awful lot of things we couldn't have done before. It's the same with meditation. You've got to ask the questions. But things get really still, and there's a movement in the mind. You've got to ask why. So here again, you've got the producer, the consumer, and the reflective self. The consumer has to have really high standards. And the reflective self has to watch. This concentration that we've produced, is it really up to snuff? Is it satisfactory? And the producer will try to create even more still states of mind. It runs up to a point where it can go only so far that way. There's always so much stillness that you can fabricate. And the reflective self then asks, okay, could there be something that's unfabricated? That's the point when the mind is really ready for this. If it hasn't done the work, it's not ready. So as you realize that there's work to be done, don't shy away from it, because the work really does pay off. There's so much work in the world that doesn't pay off. It's one of the reasons why when people come to the practice, they want to hear that it's simply a matter of letting go, of not doing, simply being. Because so much of the work in the world is pretty worthless, not very satisfying. But what's appealing is not necessarily what's good for us. So when the Buddha says there's work to be done, as John Lee says, concentration has work to do. Directed thought, evaluation. You got the directed thought and evaluation in the first jhana. And then that reflective self kind of hovers around all the levels of concentration when you're contemplating them. That fifth factor the Buddha talks about, where the analogy is of a person sitting looking at someone lying down, or a person standing looking at a person sitting, watching what the mind is doing. That gets a real workout. But it's because of that ability to reflect. After all, those two principles of finding the Dharma. You commit yourself here, you commit yourself to getting the mind still, and then you reflect. Is it still as it could be? Any potential for unstillness in there? When you keep alert like this, then there's a prospect for something special. The Buddha talks about different levels of equanimity. He divides them in different ways in different parts of the canon. There's worldly equanimity and unworldly equanimity, and then even more unworldly than unworldly equanimity. That's one system. Or worldly is simply being equanimous about things arising in the senses. Unworldly is the equanimity of the fourth jhana. And the more unworldly than unworldly, that's the equanimity that comes after awakening. Then there's equanimity based on multiplicity. That's everything up to through the fourth jhana. Then equanimity based on singleness. That's from the formless state of infinite space on up. There's householder equanimity. Again, simply making yourself equanimous about what's arising at the senses. There's renunciate equanimity that comes after you've contemplated things in terms of the three characteristics and gotten past them. So there are different ways of dividing the pie. The important thing is that realizing that simply being equanimous about things, saying, well, I don't want to get involved with things, I just want to let go. That's at the bottom of the rung, the bottom of the ladder. The higher forms of equanimity are not coming from giving up. They're from working. And then when the work is done, then you can be equanimous. So it's important to be clear about that. The mind is doing work. It's subtle work. We're not sweating out under the hot sun. Forced to trudge long miles. We're sitting here very quietly, just breathing. But the mind gets a big workout. Not so much in being clever, but just learning how to observe itself and be true to itself and be truthful with itself. I'm getting really good at taking on these three roles. Your ability to produce states of concentration, your ability to enjoy the concentration, and your ability to reflect on what you're doing. So it gets better. Those three abilities, those three selves, those are the ones that get a workout. And then when they've done their work, then you can put even them aside. But not until they've been thoroughly trained.